Welcome. In this video, we're going to consider the following question. We want to show that the map from R2 to R2, given by reflection in the y-axis, we want to show that this map is a linear map. Now, the way we're going to do this is we're going to show it satisfies the addition condition and the scalar multiplication condition. Now, these words are very similar to those that you hear in the subspace theorem, but this is not a subspace theorem. It's a question about linear maps. So, I mean, this is an interesting map, but without a formula for the map, I'm going to find it hard to answer this question. So let's first try to work out a formula for this map. So let's take a typical point in R2, say the point x1, y1. So if you look at it, the x component is x1, the y component is y1, and I want to reflect this in the y-axis. So where is this point? Well, it should have the same y component, and the x component should now be minus x1. So this gives us the point minus x1, y1. And this is the map acting on x1, y1. All right, so now we have a formula for this map. We have the map takes the vector x1, y1 to the vector minus x1, y1. All right, so now we can try and show linearity. So there are two conditions we need to check, but thankfully we can do these using just one test. So to set up for this test, let's take two vectors from R2, say A, which is the vector whose components are A1, A2, and the vector B, whose components are called B1 and B2. Both elements of R2. And let's also take two constants. In this case, I'll take lambda and mu, both real numbers. So what is it we're required to prove? Well, we're required to prove that if you take the map and apply it to lambda times A plus mu times B, well, that will be the same as if you take lambda times the map applied to A plus mu times the map applied to B. So this is really a nice way of bundling together both the addition condition and the scalar multiplication condition. So for example, if mu and lambda were both 1, then this condition just becomes the addition condition. If, say, mu was 0, then this condition just becomes the scalar multiplication condition. So we're going to be able to check both conditions with this one simple check. So let's actually do that for this map. Let's just see whether this is true or not. All right, so the map applied to lambda A plus mu B, well, what is the vector contained inside that map? That would be lambda A1 plus mu B1. And lambda A2 plus mu B2. And we know what to do with this. We already worked out a formula. This will be minus lambda A1 plus mu B1. And the second component is lambda A2 plus mu B2. And this is equal to lambda times minus A1, A2, plus mu, times minus B1, B2. Right, and this is just lambda times T applied to A, plus mu of T applied to B. And this is exactly what we were required to prove. So hence, T is a linear map. And now let's move on to the second part of this question. So for the second part of this question, we're tasked with finding the matrix representation for this linear map T. Now, because this is a linear map, I know such a representation will exist. And if I wanted to find it, I could use the matrix representation theorem, but that might be a little bit overpowered for this. So the first question we probably want to ask ourselves is, well, what is a matrix representation of T? Well, a matrix representation of T is a matrix A such that T of x is equal to a times x. So if I was to take this map, say t, apply it to x1, x2, that is just, well, it's the vector minus x1, x2. So if we expand this, it becomes x1 times the vector 1, 0, minus 1, 0, plus x2 times the vector 0, 1, and we can easily package this up in a matrix, minus 0, 1, 0, 1, times the vector x1, x2. So we can immediately read off our matrix representation for t. It's the matrix A equal to minus 1, 0, 0, 1. So like I said before, we could have found this matrix using the matrix representation theorem. So maybe let's just see how that would have come together here. So to find the first column of the matrix A using the matrix representation theorem, we need to know where the image is of the vector 1, 0, the first standard basis vector. And well, it should be quite obvious that under this reflection, this becomes the vector minus 1, 0, which is, yes, the first column of A. And to find the second column of A, well, that will be the image of the second standard basis vector. So that will be the image of the vector 0, 1. Now, this vector actually lies on the plane of reflection, so it doesn't go anywhere. It stays 0, 1, and yes, that is the second column of this matrix A. So yes, we could have found this matrix using the matrix representation theorem, or maybe we can just look at what the map is doing and just write out the matrix straight away. And thanks for watching.